person to win a seat in Congress in the Philippines. How does that make you feel?
Well, really, I never looked at my victory from the transgender point of view. I was just an ordinary candidate, the daughter of a former congressman and former congresswoman of my district. And that was basically how I looked at my victory. But later on, I would discover that people were focusing on that aspect, see, of by being the first transgender person to win a seat in the Congress.
With people claiming you as their own after winning the seat, did that prove to be a challenge?
Yes, it was a challenge, you know. That's why from the very start, even my first interviews, whether in local media or international, I always made it a point to stress the fact that I am first and foremost the representative of the First District of Bataan, because the people of the First District of Bataan were the ones who placed me where I am. So by extension, of course, I cannot deny the fact that I am a member of the LGBT community. So I took it upon myself to fight for the rights of the LGBT community.
Okay. And that fight, we're basically leading towards the discussion of the anti-discrimination bill. That fight led you towards sponsoring, towards helming, basically taking the lead in pushing for the ADB in Congress.
Yes, even before winning, let's say around 3 years before I ran, actually, I was already aware of the anti-discrimination bill and how it was faring in the previous Congresses. So when I decided that I would run and file my candidacy, one of the things that I promised was to file the anti-discrimination bill, and that I did. As soon as I assumed my post, my position, I immediately filed my version of the anti-discrimination bill.
Okay. What makes this ADB different from the past versions? Because it's been there for almost 20 years now.
You know, nothing really different when it comes to the essence or the wisdom behind the bill. There are certain terms that I wanted to fine-tune, like terms like LGBT community. I wanted to make direct reference to the community. Just some nuances, basically.
This is actually also one of the versions where the LGBT community was not lumped with other minority groups, because this is a SOGI equality bill.
Yes, yes. Actually, we have two versions of the anti-discrimination bill. I'm also a co-author of the comprehensive anti-discrimination bill, which covers discrimination on the basis of age, civil status, religious beliefs, ethnicity, even your state of health, or your bodily appearance or configuration, the other bases of discrimination. So we separated the SOGI equality bill on purpose, because you know, when you have a comprehensive bill that encompasses so many areas, the tendency is when it comes to the committee level and you start downsizing it, the first one that would go would be the one related to the LGBT. So we wanted to prevent that. We wanted something separate, to send a message to society that, you know, it is time to recognize the fact that there are Filipinos who just happen to be members of the LGBT community.
Okay. But even with the separation of LGBT SOGI specifically, you actually went farther. How did that happen?
Well, you know, further in the sense that, like, for example, we updated the term last minute to include LGBTQ, you see, in recognition of intersex and people who are, let's say, queer. That is only the difference, that's the only difference, basically. What do you mean by further?
It got approved in the second reading.
Oh, yeah, so, okay, it has progressed, it has advanced this far,
yes.
Okay. Well, we're on third reading tomorrow, and we expect a victory. Up to the very last minute, I have been writing my colleagues one by one, and they've been responding favorably.
Okay.
I would write each colleague of mine, dear so and so, in the same manner that you have treated me with respect, and with respect and with dignity, would like to ask you to extend the same respect and dignity to my brothers and sisters in the LGBT community. I would tell them, I know you have a generous heart, and you would find it in your heart to sign as co-author of this very important bill. And they would reply to me, and they would tell me, of course, Geraldine, we'll do it for you. We have discovered that you are no different from us. You're also a human being. We have to protect your rights. So that, I got very, many times it really made me cry a little out of joy. The fact that I have so many colleagues who have expressed their care and concern for me and who look up to me and respect me and treat me with dignity.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We have insider information that some faith-based organizations actually expressed some opinions against the very inclusive nature of the bill, that they wanted to be allowed to at least be able to discriminate on the basis of religion.
You know what? If we qualify, to them that they will not be prosecuted if in the exercise of their religious freedom, they should teach their followers that this, the LGBT, or your sexual, a certain sexual orientation or gender identity expression is not in accordance with your belief system, we cannot prosecute fundamentalist Christians or fundamentalist Muslims for believing and teaching that kind of thinking. But what we can prosecute is certain acts that when you deny a person his or her right to work or to study, and you cite your religious belief, that you cannot do. Of course, it's a different thing. Let's say in monasteries or seminaries, yep. We cannot oblige these monasteries that are where segregation has been a traditional practice to admit people of the opposite sex. That we can, of course, that is not covered by the bill. The bill is very respectful. It recognizes your religious freedom, but of course, your freedom ends where my freedom begins. Your right to do certain things ends where my right begins. So basically, we have limited the bill to cover the areas of work, of study, the delivery of basic and government services, also in access to commercial and public establishments, as well as, of course, the typical cases of harassment of members of the LGBT community. Those situations are covered by this bill.
With laws in general, they tend to be top to bottom. We make the laws, but how do we now ensure that if this passed, if this gets signed into a law, that the people actually benefit from it, the LGBT community particularly?
This bill, because it has been languishing in Congress for the 19 years, has drummed up so much expectation. I'm very sure and very confident with the passage of this bill. The information will trickle down. Even within the community, we would be so proud of this landmark decision, landmark move, that we will be the same ones who will be informing our brothers and sisters in the community. This is how we will trickle it down. Media will be covering this. This is a moment of celebration, a motive for celebration in our country. And I'm sure the information will trickle down. But of course, there are very few who think that this bill covers marriage equality or civil partnerships or gender recognition, which it doesn't really.
Okay. The even if it passes in Congress now, the next step will be hopefully for the Senate to have some version.
Yes. 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 But I plan to lobby. What I expect, and I ask my brothers and sisters, LGBT community is to celebrate the passage of this bill in the lower house so that maybe our counterparts in the upper house might follow suit. When they see that our counterparts in the lower body did it, why shouldn't we? And of course I plan to lobby. I've been lobbying actually in the upper house. There was a time when I distributed pink roses to every senator, and they received me quite well.
Okay.
I'm also confident because the issues that were explained to me at against the bill have already been addressed. And these are the very same issues that certain senators have. This is the CR issue. This has already been addressed in this bill.
Okay. And even if the bill is passed in the lower house, you will still have people who will bash you that you did not do enough, that you are still not really pro-LGBT because you are not supporting other human rights issues and all those stuff. You will hear those things. What do you say to them?
Well, I tell them that they have to deal with us politicians on an issue-to-issue basis. I will tell these people that no hero is 100% right and no villain is 100% wrong. Even with the death penalty vote, certain politicians surprisingly voted against. And yet I do not see these critics placing these people on a pedestal, as they have with me. I never asked to be placed on a pedestal. As I said, first and foremost, my decisions will be conditioned by the fact that I am the representative of the First District of Bataan, and the interest and welfare of my constituents will always take, will always be prioritized. So that is what I will tell these people.
And I suppose that touches on the, as I said, the elephant in the room.
Yes.
The big, huge two elephants actually, the death penalty and the CHR votes, even if you weren't really there.
Yes, right.
But those are basically issues that are being used against you now. And what can you say about those issues?
Well, my decision to vote in favor of the death penalty is based on my belief that as a representative of the First District of Bataan, I have to be their voice in Congress. And 85% of my constituents wanted the death penalty. So, much against my personal beliefs, I voted in favor. Because I view my position as representative as something that is not about me. It's about the people I represent. So I voted in favor. And of course I was bashed, widely bashed by people who had placed me and who had not learned to manage their own expectations.
Okay. Is that a fair expectation?
Well, I think they should know. They own me when they're already owners of Geraldine Romana. This is the First District of Bataan. And was it fair? I would say it was unfair, definitely. Because you cannot judge a person on just a single issue. All of us, we are multi-issue people. And as I said, you cannot find a perfect person. We have to manage our expectations. We work in an imperfect system, and we have to deal with certain realities and just try to navigate ourselves while, you know, trying to do some good. How should I even call this kind of treatment that I got? It was a form of bullying. But you know what? I'm used to being bullied. And I usually survive. Because I know deep inside that I am not an evil person. I have my limitations, but all in all, I am not an evil person.
Basically, to close this, we have the ADB now, which we hope will be passed, and I think it showed you how divided the LGBT community in itself can be.
Yes, yes, and that saddens me. You know what? The LGBT community is just a sector within Philippine society. So if you study the Philippine society as a whole, you will find out that we are diverse. We have different opinions. We have certain beliefs, we have certain ways of doing things. But if you start thinking of yourself as the absolute holder, that the soul, can you repeat that sense? If you start believing, thinking of yourself as the exclusive holder of the absolute truth, then I think you're headed in the wrong direction. Because with that kind of pride and hubris, you won't be able to listen to the opinions of others. Maybe other people have something to contribute to your own idea. Maybe in the first place you were not that correct or right to begin with. Maybe if you have a little bit of humility, you will understand why people think differently. So I want us also to learn from that. Aren't we, as members of the LGBT community, also victims of people who believe themselves to be the holders of the absolute truth? Haven't we been judged by the same kind of people with the same kind of thinking? So I ask myself, if you have this holier-than-thou attitude, what makes you different from the people who condemn and judge people from the LGBT community? If we are to survive in this society, and if we are to make advances in the LGBT community, we should be humble enough to listen to one another and respect diversity of opinion. It doesn't mean that because a person does not agree with you, he is the son or the daughter of the devil. And as I said, no one, not a political party, not a militant group, no one, not a student organization, can claim that it is the sole and exclusive holder of the absolute truth. A little humility won't hurt, and definitely unity will help us advance in our LGBT advocacy. Gandabi.